am very honored and proud to present one of my good friends and mentors of mine, Richard Horvitz.
Hi, everyone. And
I'm pretty sure many of you are familiar with some of the stuff he's done in the past. He's done quite a lot. There's some stuff that I just learned about yesterday that I had no idea.
This will be fun.
So it'll be fun to tell him the new stuff I learned about him.
Good.
All right, so give us a little introduction about yourself.
Well, let's see. I was born right here in Van Nuys, California. Actually, Los Angeles, and moved to Van Nuys. I started acting as a child at 10 years old on camera, doing television guest spots and film work in the 80s. And around 1989 or 90 or so, I switched the focus of my career to voiceover. And the minute I started, I knew I wanted to do animation. Within 5 years of deciding to go into animation, I got my first series, which is called The Angry Beavers. And that's how I started off, like around 94, yeah.
Okay, so when exactly did that moment, like, did you realize voiceover is what you want to do? Has it always been something you kind of wanted to do?
Or? No, I never set out to be a voiceover actor. I set out to be a movie star or a television star and win Oscars and Emmys and Tony Awards for Broadway. Actually, my first love is musical theater. That's where my heart really is, and theater in general is my favorite thing to do. But I guess around 1990, when the on-camera stuff wasn't going great, someone suggested I meet a voiceover agent, which I did. And I knew nothing about voiceover, but the minute I started doing, the very first job I ever did was a thing called The Adventures of Prince Valiant with Robbie Benson and Rob Paulson, and Charlie Adler was on the job. And I thought, wow, this is what I want to do. It's just like doing a stage production or a TV show, and you can be as fun and wacky as you want. And that's when I knew I wanted to do animation in particular.
So that was your very first job?
In voiceover, my very first job was a Chevy car commercial for radio where I said two words, "Bye, Dad," and that was it. Bye, Dad. I played a teenager even though I was like 30.
Okay, so what is working with you? I noticed that there's a difference between commercial and animation copy. Could you tell us what some of the big differences between those two are?
Well, I approach all my stories, as you know, I call them stories. So it doesn't matter if it's commercial or it's animation or it's TV or stage or film. I approach it all from the same place, which is story-based, meaning everything, whether it's a commercial or an animated story, has a story. In fact, commercials have a lot of story, which people don't even realize. I'll give you an example. If I said to you the sentence for, let's say, Baskin-Robbins, "Indulge in $2 soft-serve mini parfaits only at Baskin-Robbins." Do you remember this?
Yeah, well, yeah, I remember.
"Indulge in $2 soft-serve mini parfaits only at Baskin-Robbins." There's an entire story there that I could tell you. And I could say to you, I could even tell you who I'm speaking to based on the words I choose to use. So the very first word I use in that sentence is indulge. So I don't say try, and I don't say how about or would you like. I say indulge. So right off the bat, I have to look at it and say, what does indulge mean? Indulge means to give yourself a treat you wouldn't normally do, a guilty pleasure. And then I look further and I go, indulge in what? In $2 soft serve mini parfaits. They're not full-size parfaits, they're mini parfaits. So would I be speaking to if I wanted to say, I wanted to encourage them to indulge in a guilty pleasure because they're mini parfaits, they're not as many calories. So, right off the bat, I can decide I'm talking to someone on a diet or someone who's health conscious. So, suddenly I know who I'm talking to and I have an entire story. I'm with a friend who's at an ice cream shop who says, "I can't eat anything, I'm on a diet, I can't do it." And I just say to them, "Indulge in $2 soft serve mini parfaits, only at Baskin-Robbins." So, commercial stories, in animation, I approach the same. Usually the scenes are a lot different in animation. They're usually a little bit wackier and a little bit more absurd. But the only real difference is it's not how I perform, because I'm not performance-based, I'm story-based. So the only real difference to me is that who I am in the story. Yeah, who I am in a commercial story versus an animated world.
So would you say that the same amount of imagination or pretending to play would go into both of them, or would you say that the commercial copy would take a little bit more imagination because you need to build your own story for that?
It's a good question. It depends on the stories, because sometimes it's very obvious in the animation. It's very obvious in commercial, but sometimes, you know, they usually ask for 3 takes on the commercial read, which is indulge in $2 soft serve mini parfaits. And what most people do is they just change their inflection. They go, indulge in $2 soft serve mini parfaits, only at Baskin-Robbins. Indulge in $2 soft serve mini parfaits. But I always feel really fake when I'm doing that. You know, I feel like I'm trying to sell something. So I would say that, yes, there's a lot of work that goes into the commercial story to really figure out who you're talking to and why you're using the words you use.
Right. So how long have you been working in this career field at this point?
I would give away my age, Alec. 152 years I've been doing this. I am a hobbit. I have been doing this. I've been a professional actor since 1978. Which is when I got my union card. So almost, how many years is that? Almost 40 years, is that right? Almost 40 years, yeah.
Oh, I feel so old.
This may be a little hard because, I mean, it's kind of like picking favorite child, but so I gave you a little more, I gave you a fair deal with this. So
yes.
Instead of picking one favorite character, who are your 3 favorite characters that you've done?
You made that too easy, because you know what I'm going to choose. I would have to say, at the risk of not working for the people I don't choose, so you set me up, Alec, you set me up to lose my jobs. I would say, you know, Daggett from The Angry Beavers, Billy from The Grim Adventures of Billy and Mandy, and Zim from Invader Zim. That said, I'm a big fan of Tim Schafer's, so all the stuff I do for Tim Schafer, like Psychonauts, is something I'm very proud of. But also, I'm a big fan of Activision, and I've been doing Skylanders for quite a few years now, including a new TV series we're doing. So I'm pretty fond of that one, too.
Yeah, I was reading up about that. It's going to be Netflix exclusive,
it's
correct?
It's Netflix exclusive, yes. And it premieres in October, I think. That's what I'm thinking we're shooting for. And we're in the middle of season 2 right now, which is good, which is fun. So hopefully it takes off. When I first started in animation, you know, there was just, you know, 3 networks, and then it was harder to break in, but then suddenly cable exploded, and there were so many more outlets that you could work in. And now, because of the internet and because of online and people who love to binge watch, there's a whole nother market that is starting to take over. And so that would be, you know, your Amazon, your Netflix, your Hulu.
Right, so, like, without, like, spoiling anything about the show, would you say that it's more, that it would have, like, because I notice a lot of cartoons have been doing this a lot recently. They've been catering more, not, like, catering to adults, but there's a lot of jokes that, like, aren't, like, raunchy or anything, but that, like, I watch cartoons now, and I'm like, I would have never understand that as a kid. Would you say that's going to be influenced in the show at all?
I think you'll see some of that, yeah. I think the writing on this show is really, really well done. And the acting, the cast is great. Not including myself, but the other people I'm working with. But there's some things in there that might strike you differently if you're an adult versus whether you're a kid, but I don't think there's anything that's way too over your head or too mature.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, you want to expand the audience base, so that's the purpose of that.
All right. So is there anyone you haven't worked with and you
yes.
want to work with in the future?
Anyone I haven't worked with? Yes, Bruce Springsteen. It has nothing to do with voiceover, but I'd like to get on stage and sing Born to Run with Bruce. Is there anyone I haven't worked with that I... Well, you know, I haven't worked personally with Seth MacFarlane, But I really am a fan of Family Guy. I did American Dad, an episode of American Dad recently. But I really loved Beavis and Butthead originally. So, you know, I think maybe it would be great to work with him, which would be awesome, you know.
All right. So have you been in any films?
Yes. In 1985, before I think a lot of you were born, or 84 maybe, I was in a film called Summer School. It was with Mark Harmon and Kirstie Alley, and I played a kid in Summer School. I played a nerd named Alan Eakey, and it was a stretch, because I'm not really that nerdy. No, I really am. Most recently, I did a film called The Informant. I did two films recently, one called The Informant, where I played Matt Damon's attorney along with Alan Hale. And then another one I played, Crazy Stupid Love, with Steve Carell. I was the guy that worked at Lowe's. I was a Lowe's employee. And then on camera, you know, I was the Green Grapes in the Fruit of the Loom commercial for 4 years. So that was fun. If you like wearing a green grape costume everywhere, but it was a nice fun one. All those ones that they did with like the music video ones, that was the years I did them. Yeah.
So what advice would you give if anybody wanted to be in the voiceover industry?
The main thing the advice that I would give most people, in fact, I'd give every people, is that I think that sometimes people say, well, I have a great voice, or people tell me I do a lot of voices, I should do voiceover. But in voiceover, we never start with the voice. I always think it's kind of a misnomer to call it voiceover. It really should be called talkover. Because when it's called voiceover, the very first thing you do when you get your sides most of the time is go, okay, what voice am I going to use? And so what happens is you start focusing on the voice, and you forget all about your story and playing pretend in that world. So I suggest everybody who wants to do voiceover start out with acting classes or improv classes or sketch classes or, you know, do a play, those sort of things. Because most of us in voiceover came from either a musical background where you were in a band, or you were an on-camera or theatrical stage actor, which is where I came from. So that's the best place to go, because if you can play in that world, you can definitely play in the microphone world.
Yeah, like, I've noticed that, like, there's a lot of voice actors that just use their voice. Keith David is a great example. He just uses his regular voice for, like, almost everything he does.
He does,
fantastic.
But what's amazing about it is that there's a lot of people that you, like, you always know it's me in every show because my voice is distinctive, so you know it's me. But I always say, you know, if you look at, like, Robert De Niro, you can see 10 of his movies and you'll follow him into each story as that character. Even though you know it's Robert De Niro, his voice sounds the same, and you know you're looking at Robert De Niro, but you follow him into his story. It doesn't change because you're using your voice.
Yeah, like Harrison Ford is another good example of following him through different stories.
Yes.
So how long were you in Power Rangers?
752,000 years. We were in capsule. I was in it through, I think, the second half of Turbo, I think, is when I checked out. I was in it all through Mighty Morphin, and then into Turbo, and then I just left.
So, I know you were Alpha 5, but you did play a couple of villains as well.
Yeah, I don't remember those, to be honest with you, because those were, like, one-offs where they would invite you up to do something, and I did them, and I don't remember. Those were like the Disney years, I think, maybe.
Were you? Oh, sorry.
Yeah, that's right.
Were you ever in the Alpha 5 costume?
No, that's a woman in that costume.
Really?
Yes. Oh. Yes. Look at Alpha. She's got hips. So when she walks, you can see her kind of shaking her hips as she walks, and that's how we came with, hi, 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 hi. Because it was kind of like Charo, which is before most people's time here, but that's the kind of the hoochie-coochie sounds.
All right, so is there any popular series out right now that you would like to be part of at some point?
Animated or otherwise?
Why not both?
Yeah, I love Ray Donovan. I love Silicon Valley. Those are two of my favorites. I'd love to be on those shows. Voiceover-wise, I'm happy. You know, I've done a couple of new shows for Nickelodeon recently, which are fun. But I'm just kind of happy where I'm at. I like a lot of the shows that are out there.
Thank you so much.
Thank
for
you.
Down.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Thank you. I'll see you tomorrow. I'll see you tomorrow. Yeah.